Yes, sir.
Aditi joined. Yeah.
Yes.
Sir, can I off my video? My network is slow.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
Everyone, my name is Ashwini. My presentation topic is Software Industry of India. The global software product industry is currently valued at $511 billion, of which India shares is $8.1 billion. But the objective is to take India to $8 to $90 billion by 2025, said Omkar Rai, Director General, Software Technology Park of India. Speaking at the 15th Indian Innovation Summit 2019, organized by the Confederation of Indian Industry in Bengaluru, the two-day summit aims to create a stage for industry captains, young innovators, and policy makers to participate and deliberate on the nuances of innovation. Delivering the keynote address, Dr. E.V. Ramana Reddy, Additional Chief Secretary, Department of IT, Karnataka government, said, in order to emerge as a global power, India needs to work towards becoming an innovation economy. Bengaluru had been widely cited as one of the fastest growing technology and startup capitals in the world. Bengaluru is ranked 11th best global startup ecosystem as per the Startup Link Startup Ecosystem Ranking System Ranking Report 2019. Moving up from rank 21 in the year 2019, our department is in the process of drafting a new policy on innovation and technology with a view to address the new age challenges in regulation for innovation. We are considering innovation concepts such as regulatory sandboxes to ensure legal framework for innovation is available. Our aim is to make the state a leading promoter for all emerging technologies by strengthening existing technology centers of excellence in areas such as cyber security, data analysis, Internet of Things, and artificial intelligence. India IT service in the service industry currently stands at $177 billion, with export amounting to $136 billion, and the industry employs around 4.1 million people. It is the intention of the government of India to transform the country from an IT service industry to a product nation. The National Software Product Policy 2019, which has been approved by the Union Cabinet, aims to capitalize on the strength of India's IT industry in order to make the country a software product nation. STPI is in the process of opening 28 centers of excellence in emerging technologies at an investment of more than ₹400 crores. 5 each centers are currently operational, and in 2 years, all 28 will be operational. Emerging technologies such as AI, IoT, medical electronics, IoT in agriculture will be the focus of the COEs. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, Vinnie, you have done very well. The other students, you please note down. I will give you some information about software. You please note down. Yes, Vinnie told two figures. That two figures you have please note down. One is the IT industry, service industry in India, $1. You please note down. The present industrial protection are $177 billion, and the export amounting to $136 billion. The total employees in the industry as far as 1 million. The present policy of the government of India is to transform the country from IT service industry to product nation. We shall be able to produce. That is the main idea of Modi ji. And by 2025, another 4 years, the country, according to CII, CII means Confederation of Indian Industry. That is a very strengthy organization. Indian software industry will top by 80 billion dollars. That is the advantage of this industry. Number one, please note down, growing demand for the IT and the global footprint which we have. We have the global footprint all over the world. Indians are there in the industry. In the competitive advantage, these are the important information which you have to note down. Number one, growing demand for IT, global footprint, then the competitive advantage of the industry. Then India's IT industry contribution around to the country's GDP. The GDP contribution of IT industry is 7.7%. Then by 2025, it will grow to 10% with the policy support. The policy support by government of India is in 2020 of 53.108 crores for the Indian industry of software. You please note down, amount is 53.108 crores. And there is another important thing, the new national strategy. To strengthen country's security also is another important landmark which has been driven force of Modi's government. And there is an app for this that is known as Umang app, A-U-M-A-N-G. You please note down and download this Umang app and you will find what are the benefits of this. And you should be able to write an essay. If someone asks you, what is the software industry's growth in India during the last one decade? So you please note down all these points and we'll look forward for the another presentation. Parli is ready?
Sir, yes, sir.
Parli?
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Yeah, please, please.
Good evening, ma'am and sir. My topic is about the 75 years of independence, which will be marked on August 15 this year. So in March, our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi has inaugurated Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav by starting it off with the Dandi March. So this is a series of events which are being organized by the Government of India to commemorate the 75th anniversary of Indian independence. So this was launched on March 12th, and it is a government initiative to mark the 75 years of independence. Mr. Narendra Modi, our Prime Minister, said that the 75th anniversary celebrations are going to continue till August 15, 2023. So he also flagged off Dandi March from the Sabarmati Ashram in March, which ended in April. And this Mahotsav is a tribute to all our freedom fighters and the freedom struggle period. So during the celebrations, our country will not only remember the important times and milestones of our freedom struggle, but also gain a new spirit for the developments of our country, is what our Prime Minister has said. And the central government has constituted a committee under Union Home Minister, Mr. Amit Shah, to draw out the policies and planning of various events to be undertaken as a part of this celebration. And state and union territory governments are also, apart from the government of India, the union territory governments are also organizing events all over India to mark the 75 years of our independence. That's it, sir.
Sir, I
know. Right, but you please note down some points. All of you note down some points about this 75 years of independence. It should be like a balance sheet. What are the drawbacks and what are the achievements we have done? Number one, the Prime Minister office has announced that suggestions from will be taken care of in the August 15th speech of Prime Minister at the Red Fort. Every year it is a practice that Prime Minister unfurls the flag and makes some announcements about the next year by the government of India. If you go through the long run of 75 years from 1947 to we are completing 75 years by next year, and it will be like Azadi Ka Amrit Varsha. The main points which you have to make note, number one, the trials and turbulences. We have faced several threats and several problems during the entire of 75 years. You may think that I am a pessimist. I am not a pessimist. I am hopeful of India's achievements in several fields and several territories. But we have faced several trials and turbulences, which you can note down in several ways. And the Nehru policy was taken from other countries also. They have the planning commission, and we have also started the planning commission. And during the first five-year plan, second five-year plan, we have gone up to 12th five-year plan. In each five-year plan, the thrust was given for a particular industry. For example, in the first plan, during 52-57, it was for the agriculture. Then industry, like that, energy and all these things. And finally, in the 12th, they got thought of having a unified democratical system of growth. And then the big achievement is of hydroelectric projects. You please note down, we have several hydroelectric projects through the country. It is that we have priorities of agriculture. We have become a surplus state now. Earlier, we were asking for the food grains from other countries, particularly PL84 and all these things. We were getting so much of imports for the food grains. But now we are able to have food system surplus also. Our Food Corporation of India godowns are full with our own country's productions. Then Nehru's policy of socialism, he wanted to have a socialistic pattern of society. and everyone is equal. That was his argument, and that was his goal, and that was his aim. And he was able to, during his period of, he was there from 1950 onwards to 1964, May 27. He passed away on 27th of May, 1964. He ruled almost the country for more than 14 years, succeeded by Lal Bahadur Shastri, and later by Christic Pattern of Society was the main achievement of India's government. And coming to irrigation projects, we have several major dams like Nagarjuna Sagar Dam and Satluj Dam. All these things, they are the achievements of our country during the 75 years. Then coming to the public sector undertakings, Nehru that the industry through the public sector undertakings. Earlier it was only privatization, only Tatas and Birlas, they were able to contribute for the industrial development. But Nehru thought it is necessary that we should have our own public sector undertakings, and several public sector undertakings like BHEL and others, they have grown the importance of public sector undertakings. After all these achievements, there were several setbacks. What are the several setbacks? War with Pakistan twice, war with China, and besides the external conflicts, we had internal conflicts also. There was a Kashmir affair, growing evidence that the Article 370 was not able to be withdrawn. Then there was a conflict of Khalistan. You please note down. Punjab wanted to become a separate state, separate country. There was a Khalistan movement. We lost Indira Gandhi because of this Khalistan movement only. Our own security guard assassinated her. Separate state movements also. There was a linguistic minority group of Andhras. They wanted a separate state for Telugus. So the Andhra state has been formed in 1953. October 1st, Prakasham Panthulu was the first chief minister, and the headquarters was at Kurnool. Similarly, several states have started, the several states have also been bifurcated. Then comes the emergency. During 1975, Madam Gandhi, she was not able to sustain, or she was not able to control the opposition parties, and she imposed emergency, and it lasted for 18 months. And there were a lot of agitators. Jay Prakash Narayan started the movement, and it has grown up like a wildfire, and the Janata government has come into force. In 1978, they formed the government. But by 1980, the Janata government fell because of its own internal fightings. Then comes the major thrust, Narasimha Rao. You please note on, when Narasimha Rao became the Prime Minister of India in 1991, he started the economic reforms. He brought an economist, Mr. Manmohan Singh, as Minister for Finance to control and guide the nation for the financial benefits. Then liberalization, privatization, globalization, all these things put together, they formed into an economic reforms. Note down, number one is liberalization, privatization, and globalization. The assassination of Indira Gandhi and Rajiv Gandhi was a very big setback during the last two able administrators, including Lal Bahadur Shastri, who died at China when he went for a bilateral meeting. Suppose he was dead. Then we got a lot of foreign investments due to the globalization actions. This has also hindered our own growth. Normally, it is supposed to have 5-year elections, but some of the states fell, and some of the union governments also, they were not able to sustain till 5 years. 1977, the election was there. Then again, it has fallen. By 1980, another government has called prime ministers because there was no stable union government at the center. And the rise of regional parties, TDP, then comes the Anna-DMK, DMK, and several Tridmool Congress and other regional parties. It was also a hindrance for the growth of the 75 years of independence. The government, then NDA government. It was there for 10 years, UPA government headed by Manmohan Singh. Then for the last 7 years, we have NDA government of Mr. Modi. Then the growth of software industry also is a very big growth for the entire nation. So all these things you have to mention when you are come to the balance sheet. What is the advantage of 75 years of Indian democracy? What is the disadvantage? The family rule was there. For the last 3 decades, single family of Nehru, they ruled the country. They could not expect any opposition for them. Then the emergence of BJP. The BJP, which had only 2 members in the parliament, it has grown up to 80. And now in 2014 elections, they were able to form the government. Then industrialization, we have more than Tatas and Birlas in several fields, and the industrialization has gone to most of the political scenario. There are several regional parties, and the voters' ignorance has been completely ruined, and voters' awareness has come. Then the legislators, the part of legislators who are acting now in the several different state governments, the legislators or most of them are criminals in the legislation, and criminalization of politics has entered, and the electioneering costs also have grown up to several crores of rupees. If you want to contest for a Jilla Parishat member, you have to spend 1 crore. You have to contest for an MP, you have to spend 10 crores or 15 crores. So for a small man who is not having service, then the balance sheet shows, in spite of all these hindrances, for the last 75 years, we were able to grow. And the nation has created an atmosphere in the UNO also that India is a great democracy. So that is the advantage of the 75 years of democracy. Now we will move to Aditi. Aditi Chapuma.
Yes, sir. Sir, actually, I made a mistake in understanding the topic what you sent, sir. I wasn't having the phone with me, so I misunderstood the topic and I made a presentation on the wrong topic.
Aditi?
You can hear me, sir?
You did not present the paper. Your subject is Olympics.
I made a presentation on wrong topic, sir.
Yeah, no problem. Olympics, huh?
I made the presentation on the athletes of Olympics, not on their performance.
No problem. You ready or you don't want to?
I'm ready.
I'm not able to.
If I can do it on that topic, I will do it, sir.
Entamma?
I made a presentation, so I can show it if you want, sir, if that's okay.
Please do it.
Okay, sir. Can I show my screen, sir? Share my screen. Sir, I can't hear you, sir. Your voice is breaking a lot.
You can ask madam to spare this screen for you.
Yes, sir.
Share the screen, huh?
Share.
Yes, ma'am.
I'll have a sharing screen. Wait 1 minute. Yeah. Today, a little bit network issue is there.
Can you see my screen, ma'am?
Yes.
I just made a presentation on the athletes, sir. Like, how many athletes are there and stuff.
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Aditi, and today my presentation is on Indian athletes in Olympics 2021 Tokyo. India has been sending a large contingent for the last three editions of the Summer Olympics. The Tokyo Olympics 2021 will see a 228-member strong contingent from India participating in 18 sporting events. India's Olympic contingent for Tokyo 21 includes 127 participants from 18 sports, including two alternate players and one reserve goalie in men's and women's hockey squads, respectively. Sir, should I read all the names, sir?
No problem. You please read. You please, at least we'll remember them and salute them.
Okay, sir. Athletes from India, archery, Tarundeep Rai, men's recurve,
Atanu Das,
men's recurve, Praveen Jadhav. Sir, can I not read the name, sir?
Praveen Jadhav.
Yes, sir. Men's recurve, Deepika Kumari.
Deepika Kumari, yeah.
The men's trio will also compete as a team at Olympics 2021. Athletes, Katie Fran, men's 20-kilometer race walking, Avinash Sable, men's 3,000 steeplechase, Murli Sri Shankar, men's long jump, MP Jabir, men's 400 hurdles, Neeraj Chopra, men's javelin throw, Anu Rani, women's javelin throw, Sajan Darpal Singh Tur, men's shot put, Dute Chand, women's 100 meters and 200 meters, Kamalpreet Kaur, women's discus throw, Seema Punai, women's discus throw, 4x400 mixed relay, men's 4x400 relay, badminton, PV Sindhu, women's singles.
If PV Sindhu just now, in another 10 minutes back, she lost in the semifinals. Yeah, please go through.
B. Sai Praneet, men's singles, Satwik Sairaj, Rankiran Reddy and Chirang Shetty, men's doubles, boxing, Vikas Krishnan, men's 69 kgs, Lovlina Borgohain, women's 69 kgs, Ashish Kumar, men's 75 kgs, Pooja Rani, women's 75 kgs, Satish Kumar, men's 91 kgs, Mary Kom, women's 51 kgs, Amit Pangal, men's 52 kgs, Manish Kaushik, men's 63 kgs, Simranjit Kaur, women's 60 kgs, equestrian, Fond Mirza is the first Indian equestrian to qualify for the games in 20 years, fencing, Bhavani Devi became the first Indian fencer to qualify for the Olympics. Golf, Anirban Lahiri, Udayan Mane, Aditi Ashok. Gymnastics.
Is it you?
No.
right.
Pranati Nayak is only the second Indian woman gymnast to qualify for the Olympics. Hockey, men's national team, goalkeepers, P.R. Srijesh, defenders, Harmanpreet.
You can skip women's national like that.
Okay.
You skip to the main items, yeah.
Like women's, like, or judo, sir?
Women's national and then judo.
Women's national and judo. Sushilesh Devi Likmanban will be the India's first only participant in judo in Tokyo 2021. Rowing, Arun Rath, Arvind Singh, sailing, Netra Kumanan, Laser Radical, Vishnu
Saravanan. You go to the main headings. You read only main headings.
Okay,
shooting, wrestling, swimming.
Yes, sir. Shooting, swimming, table tennis, tennis, weightlifting, wrestling. The first medal is Tokyo Olympics 2021. Saikom Mirabai Chanu, born 8th August 1994.
This meeting will end now. We will let us join again and continue.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, please.